Tantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents Who Glares Wins by Camilla Chafer, narrated by Vanessa Daniels. Chapter 1. Only 2 months into my new job at the Solomon Agency, and I had the awful feeling I might have bitten off more than I could chew. It wasn't the shooting practice, I was good at that, or the stakeouts, which weren't nearly as exciting as in the movies. No, it wasn't that at all. My problem was I was fairly sure my new colleagues, a coterie of ex-detectives, seasoned agency men, and one former criminal, didn't take me seriously. My boyfriend certainly didn't regard my new career seriously, that was for sure. Nope, Detective Adam Maddox thought it was cute that I was now a woman crime fighter, and put it all down to an addiction to the adrenaline rush from my most recent brush with death. Vincent Marciano, company accountant and serial killer, was now behind bars, and everyone thought I should get over all the excitement. Everyone, that is, except my boss, John Solomon. Quite possibly the only bad guy on the good guy's side. I liked him a whole lot. After retiring from whatever he was doing for the government, and my decision not to return to temping hell, Solomon offered me a job at his new agency. If he thought I could become a card-carrying, licensed private investigator, I was going to damned well try my best, supportive colleagues or not. Solomon was currently ensconced in his office, a small glass-walled corner off the larger space I shared with four other men. We were all on the second floor of a mostly unoccupied building in downtown Montgomery. With Solomon was Steve Fletcher, and since the door hadn't shut fully, I could just hear their conversation. Given its direction, all I could hope was that my cheeks weren't turning pink from mortification. My colleagues came with a shared lifetime of Army, police, national security, and in Lucas, don't call me by my surname ever, Givens' case, nefarious computer skills. I also suspected some jail time with him, although he'd stopped twitching so frequently. I, meanwhile, brought to the table brilliant administration skills, a good eye for body language, a mind fit for crime solving, and today, the cutest polka dot peep toe pumps known to woman. Given the glances I received, first from Fletcher, then Solomon, I figured they weren't talking about my excellent taste in footwear. Every so often, I caught the phrase, "not ready," and "not enough training," and "are you serious?" from Fletcher. Fletcher was a hard nut, and the word crack wasn't in his vocabulary. Unless you counted single-handedly busting a Mexican cocaine cartel while taking two bullets in the leg. He walked with a limp and a scowl. He was a few years older than I and had seen things I hoped never to see. He seemed to like reminding me of that, too. Well, he could bite me. Solomon turned away and picked up his cell phone, tapping a few keys before returning it to his desk. A moment later, my phone vibrated. I picked it up, wrenching my sneaky peripheral vision away from my whiny colleague and blinked at the message. "Did you just mouth bite me?" I looked up, gaping at Solomon, while knitting my eyebrows together just so. One corner of his mouth lifted into a knowing smile. I inhaled my gasp and dropped my gaze to the paperwork amassed on my desk, my eyes wide. Unable to resist my curiosity at how he felt about biting me, I peeked a glance through my perfectly mascaraed lashes. I saw that Solomon hadn't looked away, and his eyebrows were slightly raised. He commented softly on Fletcher's reticence and shook his head, without taking his eyes off me, but his face revealed nothing. I fought the urge to send a cheeky wink in his direction, and instead grabbed the desk phone just as it started to ring. I had to shift slightly in my seat to keep Solomon out of my line of sight. "Hello?"
"This is Jim on front desk," came the cigarette-smoking voice of our receptionist slash security guard.
His voice sounded like crunching gravel.
"Your appointment just arrived."
"Thanks, I'll be right down."
I slipped my feet back into the peep toes, smoothed my dress, and left the office with my head held high and my back ramrod straight. I was determined not to give Fletcher the satisfaction of seeing how his words stung me. Taking the elevator down one floor to the small, sparsely furnished entrance lobby, I noticed the walls had recently been painted a soft gray and the wooden floor was buffed to gleaming. I looked around. There was only one person waiting, and she looked up when I entered. She glanced over, taking me in from head to polka-dotted toe, then looked down at the magazine she held open in her hands. Her black hair fell around her chin to frame her sweetheart face. "That her?" I mouthed to Jim, and he nodded. I took a moment to look her over before I approached. Elizabeth Fong was dressed for business in a neat black suit, the skirt exactly to her knee. She had it accessorized with low-heeled black Mary Janes, a white top, and a large black purse with a discreet logo. The suit was off the rack, but the purse was very nice, and I suspected she must have saved for it and used it every day, taking visible pride in her professional attire. Her hair was cut into a sharp bob, straight and jet black, and her lips bore a liberal application of pink gloss, the only makeup she wore. She was neat, orderly, and guaranteed not to stand out in a crowd. Judging by the circles under her eyes, however, she looked like she hadn't been sleeping too well. I walked over to her and inclined my head. "Elizabeth Fong?" She looked up, blinked, eyeing me over again, and paused on my pink shift dress. I resisted the urge to smooth the imaginary creases out and waited for her to respond.
"Yes," said Elizabeth Fong, then, "is he ready for me?"
I frowned. "He?"
"Lex Graves."
This was the third time since starting this job that this happened. From the periphery of my sight, I noticed Jim Hurd, but he just shook his head and focused on the worn paperback in his hands, saying nothing. I would have put money on it that he'd set a few people straight too, without saying a thing to me. "Lexi Graves," I corrected her.
"Oh."
Elizabeth blinked back in surprise. "Why don't you follow me?" I stepped back and waited for her to rise, then beckoned her to follow me into one of the meeting rooms off the lobby. Most private investigators saw clients in their offices, but Solomon preferred that we kept our office space separate from where we met potential clients. That was probably a good thing, given that our shared desk space didn't offer much privacy, and the boardroom required a walk between the desks, something that made clients uncomfortable. When people hired a private investigator, they usually wanted to keep their business quiet, I soon discovered. Elizabeth would be no different. Whatever managed to bring her here was troubling her. I swiped my key card into a corridor that took us down to the first floor of the agency and showed her into the main meeting room. It was an anonymous space, only a nondescript round table with four chairs, the furniture being one of the perks of the building. A phone used for the conference calls sat on top, and there was a laptop connection too. The blinds were usually closed, which was fine by me because this side of the building had a lovely view of the dumpsters. But soft light filtered through the plastic slats, giving the client nothing to view and nothing from which they could make any assumptions. They didn't know if we were busy or quiet, neat or untidy. They couldn't make any suppositions whatsoever, personal or business related. I suspected that was Solomon's plan, given that the agency was as new as my tenure. Most of all, though, it meant clients couldn't poke around in places their eyes weren't meant to see. I thought the room could use a plant, at the very least, but Solomon didn't take my suggestion of a ficus very well.
"I was hoping to meet a private investigator, but I guess you'll do."
Elizabeth smiled at me hopefully, but not at all apologetically.
"It's hard to get anyone to take me seriously."
"I am a private investigator," I explained patiently, knowing exactly what she meant about being taken seriously, but resisting the urge to point out the irony of the moment. I knew what the problem was. Elizabeth Fong expected a grizzled old ex-detective, probably with a paunch and nicotine-stained fingers, who talked in staccato bursts and had seen too much evil in the world. In short, not me. Even though my hair had recently returned to brunette, and I didn't resemble the peppy blonde I'd once been anymore, I still had a serious case of the cutes. Usually that worked for me. In Elizabeth's eyes, however, I clearly read, unprofessional.
But you're...
a chick? It happens. It was partly why Solomon hired me. I did not look like anyone's expectations of a private detective. Case in point, I was disarming. When Fletcher walked into a building, people thought cop. When I walked into a building, I got hit on. Why don't you tell me why you came to see me? I suggested, cutting to the chase. Elizabeth paused, clearly wondering if I was worth her time, then seemed to decide, yes, I was.
It's like this. My friend is missing.
The woman threw her hands in the air, clearly already exasperated, and her concern started to flow.
No one will take me seriously, she repeated. I went to the police as soon as I thought Marissa was missing, and they said it was too early to know. So I waited a few more days, and then they said maybe she ran off. So I waited another week, and they checked her place out because I was being a pest, and found nothing. But I knew someone went through her apartment, because she's neat, you know, and I could tell.
I did know. I would know if anyone had been in my apartment. Perhaps it was a woman thing. None of my three brothers could detect if a tornado had paid a visit to any of their places.
How long has she been missing?
2 weeks now. It's not like her. Really, it isn't.
You say the police think she...
I looked down at my one-word note. Marissa, I continued, might have taken off? The woman nodded.
But you don't think so. Why don't you tell me about that?
Well, they think Marissa took off because she's got no one here. She was a foster kid, so she doesn't have any family, and her job wasn't an exciting, high-flying one. It was kind of dull. They think maybe she got bored, and she met some guy and took off. But I know her. She's my best friend. Marissa wouldn't go anywhere without telling me first.
Have you been close very long?
6 years. There's no chance she met a guy, decided to take off and do something different with her life. It wasn't exactly unheard of. People change their lives on a whim sometimes.
No. She broke up with her last boyfriend 2 years ago, and she wasn't into dating. Said she was fed up with losers.
I pondered that. A woman missing for 2 weeks and her best friend insists she wouldn't leave without a word. Worst case scenario? She was dead already. Clearly, that had already crossed Elizabeth's mind because she took a deep breath and closed her eyes, biting her lip gently.
Okay, there's a form I need you to fill out, I told her.
I need to review the case with the agency before I can tell you if we'll take it. Agency policy, I told her. Trying to be gentle. How would I feel if my best friend, Lily, disappeared? Well, after appropriating some coveted items from her closet, I'd be very distraught. I walked over to the cabinet, unlocked it with a small key on my keychain, and extracted the missing persons form, with the Solomon Agency logo printed in the top right corner. It was 4 sheets long and asked for a litany of information. Anything from the basics of name, date of birth, and address, to work history, friends, known disagreements, passport and bank details. I handed it to the woman and she flipped through it quickly.
I don't know the answers to some of these, but I can get them.
Fill in what you know now, I said, and bring in the rest whenever you can. As soon as possible, we talk over potential cases every day.
So you'll take the case? She asked,
hopefully. I don't know yet. It depends on what my boss says. It went like this. When a case came in, we got all the details from the prospective client and, as a team, discussed its merits and what we thought we could do, as well as what resources were necessary to solve the case to the client's satisfaction. I'd only worked on one missing person case so far, but I knew it was sometimes as simple as monitoring the missing person's financials and just waiting for them to show up. Sometimes it took more effort, like in a custody case, and sometimes it was something we didn't want to touch, like a stalker who wanted more information about the person he was obsessing over. I sat in on a meeting like that with Solomon, and it still gave me the heebie-jeebies. If we got a bad feeling or suspected something of a serious criminal nature, we'd pass it on to the police. This was probably the only area where I trumped my colleagues, although each one of us had contacts with the local police. I had 19 serving family members in the Montgomery Police Department. The retired ones pushed the count even higher. "I don't have a lot of money," Elizabeth said, once she finished filling in all the details she knew and passed the form back to me. I scanned her neat writing. "But I need to know Marissa's okay." "Understood," I said, passing her the client request sheet. "Write your details down here, and someone will give you a call. I'll bring in everything else you need this afternoon." "Thanks. Leave it with the guy behind the desk when you come in." I opened the door for Elizabeth, and she paused, her eyes suddenly frightened. "Please take the case," she said, reaching for my hand. Waves of worry poured from her. "I don't have anywhere else to turn." "I'll give it my best shot," I said, which meant nothing, unless we took the case. "Do you have a best friend?" Elizabeth asked me, stopping in the doorway. I only had a moment to steady myself to avoid crashing into her. I smiled. "Yes, I do." "If she disappeared and everyone told you not to bother looking, would you? Especially if you thought something bad might have happened to her." The pain on her face, combined with the slight pressure of her hand on my arm, implored me to say no. I thought about Lily. "I'd never stop looking," I said, which was true. I spent the next hour at my desk, studying the forms Elizabeth Fong filled out. She knew most of the basics. Marissa Widmore was a 28-year-old college dropout. She didn't stay at any job longer than a year, according to Elizabeth, who had filled out 6 years of work history. It was mostly blue-collar, waitressing, shop work, some office temping. Nothing that would say, "This salary is too big to turn my back on." Marissa didn't have any next of kin listed. Instead, Elizabeth had added her own details. Marissa lived in Frederickstown, a poor but nice neighborhood. You could leave your car parked on the street and come back to find it still had all its wheels, although you might think twice about walking around after dark. The population was predominantly lower-income families, young couples just starting out, singles who couldn't afford anywhere better, and retirees who'd never made much progress up the salary scale. The deal was simple. You started out in Frederickstown, but you didn't want to end up in it for life. If you aimed really high, you'd choose a house in Bedford Hills, a neighborhood of large homes on spacious lots with their own indoor gyms, pools, and often staff. Or Chilton, if you preferred the old brownstone buildings. Mostly, families and couples moved to places like West Montgomery, where I lived, a nice area made up of small, converted apartment buildings and single-family dwellings. Singles usually moved to Montgomery Central and bought neat, boxy apartments close to the restaurants, coffee shops, and buildings where they worked. Harbridge was another decent residential neighborhood. If they could afford somewhere better, wanted more space, and didn't work downtown. Frederickstown's main problem was that the town planners forgot about transportation when they created the area and couldn't keep up with Montgomery's booming population. By the time they addressed it, the area had already ghettoized and was poor. It might be hard to abandon a really nice home that you'd made your own, but most people didn't have much of a problem leaving Frederickstown behind. No boyfriend listed, but there was a name and address for the guy Marissa had been seeing up until a couple of years ago. There was no reason given for the breakup,
but Elizabeth noted that Marissa wasn't upset. Three friends were listed, and Elizabeth included their phone numbers and addresses. There was no current employment, which I found odd, because already I got the impression that Marissa was a grafter. She might not stay in a job long, but she always had one. She couldn't afford not to. Plus, judging by her eclectic work history, she had a lot of transferable skills. She was adaptable to whatever job was available and didn't seem stuck on any one thing. I peeled off a bright yellow sticky note, wrote, "Job?" on it, and stuck it to the sheet, with the colored edge sticking out. I could see why the police hadn't looked any further. Other than Elizabeth, Marissa didn't have any strong ties to Montgomery. No important job, no nice apartment, no boyfriend, no future to look forward to. Except that last bit was only an assumption. Who knew what hopes and dreams Marissa had? Mid-afternoon, just when I was getting bored and half of my colleagues had disappeared, I got a call from Jim, telling me Elizabeth had dropped off an envelope. I collected it and waited until I was back in my chair before I slid my thumb under the flap and tore it open. The second form was completely filled out, including bank information, the type of car Marissa drove, and the plates. Entering the password into my laptop, I called up a couple of programs Solomon installed. One was a credit check agency, and I ran background checks on Marissa first, then on Elizabeth. I knew Elizabeth didn't have a lot of money because she said so, but it never hurt to know what her financial patterns were, especially if we took the case. Solomon didn't share the business's financial information with me, but since he'd never taken a pro bono case, I had to assume he wanted to turn a profit. The search for Marissa now moved to whether there was anything unusual to flag. Had she taken out a loan? Or gotten a new credit card? Did her spending exceed her income? Was she making payments for anything unusual? Or had she withdrawn all her money recently? Those sorts of things. Next, I placed a call to Maddox, my number one police contact, and the man voted most likely, in my head anyway, to turn my insides mushy. He answered after a couple of rings. "This is a nice surprise," he said in a warm voice. I heard a loud creak and imagined him leaning back in his chair, amidst paperwork that had already passed from one detective to another, strewn across an ancient desk, its wood scored over many decades. The steady hum of background chatter filtered down the line. "Hi, Adam," I said, my stomach doing a little flop at the sound of his voice. "It's a work call, sorry."
"Trade you."
"Pardon?"
"You're going to ask me to check on something or do something. I want to trade."
I imagined the smile in his eyes.
"Hmm?
You're a terrible snitch. What do you want?" I smiled to myself. No matter how often I bugged Maddox over the past couple of months, he always helped out, usually with a suggestion, like how to tail someone without being seen, or easy tells for liars. However, I wasn't going to take his advice on handcuffs again. Sometimes, however, I called him just because I liked hearing his voice. After all, there were plenty of other people I could call at MPD, and we both knew it.
"Dinner. My place. Tonight."
That was surprisingly easy. "Done."
"You can bring the food."
Ah, the catch. "Ha! Okay. You got me. And it's no problem. What do you want?"
"You pick. And now you've driven a hard bargain."
Maddox laughed.
"What do you want?"
"Can you run a plate for me?"
"Any reason why?"
"A case. I'm not sure yet. I just want to know if the car's been flagged."
"Sure."
He agreed, not bothering to lecture me on the legality, or lack thereof, for a PI to request confidential information from a cop. I gave him the plate and hung up when he said he would call me back on my cell phone. I was pretty pleased about tonight's date, not to mention the forthcoming information. Talking to Maddox was pleasurable, and I suspected he knew it. Elizabeth and Marissa's financial reports wouldn't be back for a while, so I powered down my laptop and locked it in my desk drawer.
I'm out of here, I said, waving to Lucas, computer wonder boy, and Tony Delgado, an ex-military man built like a linebacker, before leaving. I preferred taking the back stairs to walk down to the underground parking lot we shared with the other occupants of the building. Solomon was on his way up. I spotted his ultra-short, black hair bobbing up the stairs as he took them two at a time. He came into view only a moment before he saw me. I'm heading out, I told him, as I paused on the small half-landing. Solomon wore his usual thigh-hugging jeans, though I didn't think he wore them for the effect it had on me, which was somewhere between skipping a heartbeat and drooling, and boots that looked beaten from years of wear. Today, they were paired with a dark-knit V-neck sweater, its narrow incline exposing a black t-shirt with just a hint of dark skin. Over his shoulder, he carried a backpack. I wondered where he'd been the past couple of hours, and if it had anything to do with his conversation with Fletcher. I noticed they both disappeared while I attended to Elizabeth. Solomon raised his eyebrows, eyeing me over as he climbed the last two steps and came to a stop next to me. He was looking down at me expectantly. I waited for him to tell me that it wasn't working out or that Fletcher was right and I really wasn't cut out for sleuthing. But he just nodded. The corners of his lips edged into a smile, the kind of smile to make a heart forget its job.
I can see that. Working?
Solomon employed everyone on a flexible hours basis. The idea was simple. Cases like the ones the agency took were not on a 9-to-5 daily basis, so neither were we. However, if, for instance, surveillance was needed in the evening, we had to do it, and weekends were never off limits. On the plus side, sleeping in wasn't a problem, and I could take off for a day or two as long as nothing was happening. Despite my years of office work and keeping regular hours, I liked this new arrangement much better, regardless of the haphazard hours. Checking a few things out, a missing person came in, I told him. He grinned, his liquid chocolate eyes amused.
Case solved.
I gave him a little eye roll, not enough to see brain, but enough to show him he wasn't funny. Even though he was, because I had to nip the insides of my cheeks to stop the smile that nearly appeared.
Any red flags? He continued.
I shook my head. None yet. The police aren't interested, apparently, but her best friend thinks there's something off. I see no reason for the woman to vanish, and no reason for her not to. I lifted one shoulder in a shrug and let it drop.
Bring it to the meeting tomorrow.
Solomon's daily office meeting was the time when we talked through various cases and their merits before deciding on our workloads. It wasn't completely obligatory, but it also wasn't ignored.
I may have something for you as well.
Okay. See you tomorrow.
Lexi.
Solomon nodded and turned away to continue mounting the stairs. I breathed a sigh of relief. Still had a job. I clattered down the last flight of stairs hurriedly before it crossed Solomon's mind to fire me and made my way across the lot to my VW. Solomon's black Lexus LX was parked in the space next to it, looking like the car my car dreamt it could be. I tried not to feel guilty about stretching the truth. It was true that I was going to check on a couple of things. For one, I wanted to run by Marissa's place and see if anything stuck out. Mostly, though, I intended to run home, shower, change, and get some food to take to Maddox's place. Solomon, however, did not need to know that. Solomon and I maintain a strictly professional relationship. Not long ago, when we worked our first case together, and before Solomon started his own company, there was some kissing involved. Very, very nice kissing. The type that makes you heat up from inside out and makes your mind turn to marshmallow fluff, rendering you unable to think of... Where was I? Oh, yeah. Solomon even kissed me when he offered me the job, and I kissed him back when I took it. Since then, nada. Nothing. Zipperoonie. Of course, that could have a lot to do with my seeing Maddox.
Maddox and Solomon were colleagues for a short while, working on a joint task force to investigate a multi-million-dollar fraud, a case I ultimately cracked, but I wouldn't call them friends. As far as I knew, they hadn't seen each other since then. Still, even though Solomon didn't press for anything more, and I didn't offer, I considered it more polite not to push my relationship with Maddox in his face. Plus, if I spent all day twirling my hair and giggling about my hot cop boyfriend, I could definitely kiss my job goodbye. I buckled up and headed out, pointing the car towards Frederickstown, while trying not to think about Solomon's lips on mine. I took the job because I wanted it, and because Solomon promised to train me, not because he was hotter than a volcano. But every so often, I saw him looking at me in a way that wasn't strictly professional. And every so often, I caught his eye and held it for a split second longer than I needed to before looking away. Playing games didn't seem wise, not with my job, and certainly not with a man like Solomon. Definitely not until I found out where things were heading with Maddox. Given my colleagues' first impressions of me, largely due to my non-PI background, and for which, ironically, Solomon decided to employ me, my job felt precarious enough as it was. I did not need to add any emotional entanglements to the issue. As I meandered through traffic, my thoughts turned to Maddox. I liked him a lot. It was too early to say whether there was, or would be, love, but I felt a lot of affection for him and received a lot back. So far, our dating life was relaxed, calling each other as and when, with normally not more than a couple of days elapsing. Our relationship had quickly progressed to the sleeping together stage and was now in regular sleepover territory. But although he'd stayed over at my place, I had yet to stay at his. My cheeks flushed and my heart sped up. Possibly that was the invitation for tonight. Fabulous. I pulled up outside Marissa's apartment building, parking on the street, and shut off the engine. I sat there, just watching for 10 minutes, until the heat completely dissipated from the car. No one came in or out, and no cars entered the small lot to the side of the building. I checked my file for Elizabeth's description of Marissa's car, but there was no small Honda. I grabbed my purse, made sure my notepad and pen were inside, then walked over to the building. 6 names were written against the buzzers on the door, and I jotted them down before walking back to my car. I sat a while longer, wondering where Marissa was, then drove home. I was buzzed because tomorrow I might have a case of my own. Chapter 2. An hour later, Lily, my best friend and downstairs neighbor, and I managed to coordinate our exits. On a date? I asked, taking in her short black dress and high heels. An early dinner, she said, nodding in the affirmative. She held up a garment bag and pulled a face. And then I'm working the door at Paradise. We both knew what that meant. Paradise was a fun club with cheap booze and a big dance floor, but something of a meat market. People went there to do 2 things: get drunk and meet the opposite sex. 2 activities that went hand in hand. Of course, that also meant the patrons got lippy, and Lily, in her job as host and door manager, got to deal with them before sicking the bouncers on them. You? Dinner with Maddox at his place, and hopefully the horizontal tango. I wasn't nearly so well dressed, but after a day in the dress and heels, I was comfortable in jeans and a silky top, the peep toes back in place. I tossed some extra clothes in a small overnight bag that really could masquerade as an obscenely large purse, just in case I read the signals wrong and Maddox only intended dinner, not a sleepover. Excellent, said Lily. Have fun. Do everything I like to do. Even the nasty stuff? Especially that. Do that twice. I stopped by Monty's Slices, the best pizzeria in Montgomery, for a large chicken pizza and a side of salad, for no other reason than to pretend we had something healthy on our plates. Then I drove the rest of the way to Maddox's. Maddox lived in Harbridge, an area realtors like to call up and coming. That meant delis selling foreign cheeses and nice wines sprang up. Coffee bars became the norm, and housing prices were starting to soar out of achievable reach. There were smug couples everywhere. I smugly assimilated. Halfway between my place and Maddox's, I pulled over and sat for a moment, looking at the dream house I yearned for. It was a buttery yellow bungalow with a neat little yard out front and mansard windows in the roof. Seeing it en route made the drive more pleasurable and heartbreaking, because I couldn't see how my income could ever stretch to afford it. With a sigh, I pulled out and continued on, the scent of pizza filling my nose. Like me, Maddox had an apartment on the second floor, but his place was slightly larger than mine. He bought it when his building went co-op. He buzzed me in and was waiting with the door open while I skipped up the stairs and straight into his arms. Maddox is delicious, inside and out. Today, he wore his suit pants and an open-necked blue shirt, the tie long gone, so he clearly hadn't been off duty long. His jaw was dusted well past a 5 o'clock shadow, and his hair was cut very short, ridding it out of the unruly growth that just added to his sexiness. Inheriting dark-haired jeans and a quick wit, his fondness for St. Patrick's Day is more focused on the beer and less to do with his Irish heritage, one that dates some way back in his family tree. My brothers respected him, my parents thought he was great, and my sister hadn't said anything condescending when they met, so he was doing very well in the boyfriend stakes, too. I stood on tiptoes and kissed him a long, long time. Pizza delivery? The pizza boy at Marcello's never delivers like this. Does he kiss? Maddox pulled a face and pushed the door shut. No. Why? You looking for a tip? Betty doesn't suggest taking his clothes off either. I smirked and sidled past Maddox to lay the box on the small two-person dining table that occupied a sizable chunk of his kitchen. Are you offering? Maddox's hands went around my waist and he kissed me again. I was suggesting you might want to slip into something more naked. I playfully flicked the button of his shirt, then another, and, oh well, the rest too, pushing it back to reveal a firm chest, peppered with fine hair. Yummy.
I've heard you talk that way to pizza. You look at pizza the same way, too.
Yeah, I agreed, tugging the shirt from his waistband. There are some things that I really like.
I've got something else you'll really like.
Naughty. I kissed him again.
Not that, but I'll suggest that in, 30 seconds.
Maddox winked, his hand sliding under my top.
I ran your plates.
I raised my eyebrows and stopped the nibbling on his neck. And you got something?
If you stop doing that, I won't tell.
Fine, but this is purely in the name of work, just so you know. I nibbled his neck some more, making my way up to his jaw. Keep talking, I reminded him when a rumbling moan sounded in his throat.
The car was impounded 10 days ago. It's been sitting in the impound lot ever since.
Have I mentioned you're a brilliant detective? I said, and this time I got his mouth. He sucked my lower lip before his tongue searched for mine.
I'm good with my hands, too,
Maddox murmured between kisses. Prove it. Maddox swiped the pizza box out of the way, tossing it onto the counter. He proceeded to prove it enthusiastically on the kitchen table, with our clothes pooled in a heap on the tile floor. 3/4 of a still-warm pizza and an hour later, he also proved it on the couch, before tucking us under a heavy wool blanket. My head lay on his bare chest and he stroked my hair. The only light came from the flicker of the television, which was turned down low. I was warm, cozy, and very, very relaxed. If I never had to move again, that would be just peachy.
Tell me, what's going on with the owner of this car?
He asked. I hope you weren't thinking about that during sex. I planted a kiss on his chest, about an inch from a small, pert nipple. I licked it, and Maddox's hand stopped the stroking, and he sighed.
No. Just popped into my head.
Solomon doesn't want us talking about cases out of the office. He made that very clear the day he assembled the team, introducing us to one another and laying down the rules. Working contacts was fine. Discussing our cases, however, Solomon stated plainly, was not.
I just gave you vital information.
We both knew Maddox was playing with me. He knew I could have gotten the info elsewhere, and I said as much.
So it was an excuse to talk to me?
He asked, pretending to be surprised with a mock gasp of astonishment. I wiggled my eyebrows at him. I wanted the info, too.
You don't need an excuse to talk to me. Just call and say hey.
I know. I snuggled in, drawing my feet under the blanket, briefly wondering where my clothes were. Ah, yes, the kitchen floor.
Are you staying over?
If that's an invitation, yes.
It's an invitation. Now you have to answer my question, or I'll bug you all night.
Geez, you're not a cop for nothing.
Stop deflecting, he said,
his hand sliding down my back and under the blanket. I thought about it. There was no particular reason that I could think of not to tell Maddox. Besides, we hadn't even taken the case yet. Maddox might have a hint or two for me, and that couldn't hurt either. I was confident about my investigative skills, such as they were, but I wasn't a fool. I still needed help while I learned the ropes. It wasn't just learning how to assess people, along with working off a hunch. It was the tools of the trade, too. The computer programs, the questioning, the surveillance, learning how to protect myself from people who weren't happy about an investigation. Not that I wanted it to come to that.
I had a gun permit and a SIG compact locked in a drawer in my apartment, but I hadn't gotten to the point where I felt the need to carry it.
The owner might be a missing person, I said, keeping my info to the bare minimum. Her best friend came to the office to ask us to look for her.
She should have reported it to the police, replied Maddox.
She did. You guys weren't interested.
Must have been a reason.
His fingers danced across my lower back, and I held my breath. Not a good one, according to her friend.
You going to look for her?
Maybe, if Solomon wants us to take the case.
How's working for Solomon going?
You still haven't seen him? I asked, surprised. Sure, they weren't buddy-buddy, but I expected them to run into each other from time to time.
No.
Really? He's been here weeks. Or longer, I wasn't sure. Solomon didn't get personal and wasn't real chatty. I didn't even know where he lived. Solomon and Maddox both insisted they weren't friends or didn't hang out, which I thought meant the same thing. But they had worked together closely in the past. I still saw people I worked with. Well, not Vincent, although he did send me a postcard from jail, which I filed in the trash can.
I haven't seen him.
I shrugged and moved on. It's going okay. Mostly he's teaching me stuff or sending me out with one of the guys to follow around. The other guys are all experienced, a lot more experienced. You might know Matt Flaherty. He's XPD. I haven't had my own case yet.
Name sounds familiar. Solomon say what kind of cases you might get?
No. He wants everyone to do everything. I mean, not just specialize in one thing.
What about the dangerous stuff?
Maddox asked, his voice light, though I spotted the hesitancy. My fingers traced the small wound on his shoulder where he'd taken a bullet. I had a matching one. He didn't want me in any danger. I don't know. Maybe, I said, keeping my voice light too. I actually hadn't thought about it in depth. I couldn't see how Montgomery could be dangerous,
Our only serial killer in recent decades was behind bars. How bad could Montgomery be? I'd lived here my whole life, and violent crime wasn't high up on the crime dar here.
I don't like the idea of him putting you in danger.
Maddox's finger traced the small scar on my upper arm. For a moment, both our fingertips touched the spots on our bodies that entwined us to one place, one time, forever. I'm not going to sack off jobs because they might get a little dangerous, I said, running my hand down his arm. Besides, a missing person doesn't sound dangerous.
I don't want to come over as the overprotective boyfriend, and I'm not telling you what to do, not at all. But I worry about you working for Solomon.
Why? I said, but my brain was saying, he said the B word, a word that still sent a thrilling ripple through me. It wasn't something we'd ever come out and announced, even though, as far as I was concerned, the dating was exclusive. Asking him if he were my boyfriend just seemed immature. After he definitely seemed like my boyfriend, approximately 2.5 months ago, it was too late to ask anyway.
Solomon is tough, as I suspect he's been involved in dodgy shit all his life. I've asked around quietly, but no one knows anything about him. Not even my FBI contacts.
So he's private. I shrugged as I raised my head from his chest to look at him. Tell you what, I'll let you know if I get worried about anything, and you can do the cool boyfriend rescue thing, okay?
Deal, said Maddox. And you can tell him, if you ever get hurt working for him, he won't make it alive to county lockup.
I seem to think my brother said something similar about you once.
Excellent.
Maddox raised his brows and grinned devilishly.
Help.
Maddox!
What? I'm making friends with your brothers. Our baseball team plays Garrett's next week, and I saw Daniel and Jordan O'Grady's. They both said hello without pretending their hands were guns and making like they were going to pop me.
Sounds like progress, I said.
So you'll come to the game?
I'll even cheer you on. But I plan to sit in the neutral seats and cheer my brothers, too. And take Lily. And my sisters-in-law. Safety in numbers if there was any question about loyalty cheering.
Want to go out afterwards?
You bet.
What do you want to do now?
Maddox's other hand slipped under the blanket, and I shivered in a very pleasant way as he ran it down my side. Go to bed, I said.
Tired?
You wish.
Round 3 it is.
I woke a half hour later than intended and found Maddox's side of the bed empty. With a groan, I shuffled out of the blissfully warm covers and showered in his attached bathroom. I wondered if it was bad etiquette not to ask first, although it had never bothered him before. Then I dressed in the clothes I'd brought with me, smart pants, a top with a couple of buttons at the neck, and black heels. I was pleased with my foresight. Yesterday's clothes could be stored in the VW's trunk while I went to work, and no one would be any the wiser. When I went into the kitchen, Maddox was sitting at the small table we'd violated the night before, eating cereal. He looked up and a slow smile spread across his face.
Morning. What time do you have to be in? He asked.
Flexi time. Whenever I like, so long as I make the afternoon meeting. I told him as I leaned down to kiss him. I had a fleeting image of being flat on my back on the table pop into my head. I kissed him again and reached for the cereal before I got more ideas.
Me too,
he said.
Want to go back to bed?
I thought I wore you out.
I'm in training, he said, a wicked gleam flashing in his eyes. You won't know what's hit you in a month.
I laughed and poured a bowl, sitting in the empty chair. I was thinking it was nice to get up with someone, eat breakfast with him, and already be looking forward to seeing him before I'd even left. I wouldn't categorize myself as a must-be-in-a-relationship person or a die-hard single, but I liked this. It felt right. It was warm and comfortable. Humping like bunnies worked for me, too.
I'm probably working late tonight, Maddox told me as he got up and rinsed out his bowl. What are you doing over the weekend?
Lunch with my parents on Sunday and babysitting for Garrett in the evening. Other than that, nothing.
You want to do something Saturday?
Sure.
There's a concert in the park, a last hurrah for summer.
Sounds nice.
I'll call you and let you know the details.
I left with Maddox, and he walked me to my car, kissing me again. He whispered something dirty about flexi time that made me blush before he retreated around the side of the building to retrieve his car from the residence lot. 15 minutes later, I pulled into the lot of the Solomon Agency, still trying to wipe the smile off my face. Neither Flaherty nor Delgado were in yet, though Fletcher was obviously engrossed with something on his laptop screen. I used the time to power up my laptop. The reports were back on the financial information I'd requested. It made for quick reading. Both women had good credit histories. They paid their bills on time and didn't live beyond their means. Both had credit cards. Elizabeth's balance was zero. Marissa owed $215. There was nothing suspicious in the way of random large deposits or sudden loans or withdrawals. I printed the reports out, adding the pages to the file, and made a note that Marissa's car was in the impound lot. That detail caused me concern. Why hadn't she claimed it? Solomon strolled in with Delgado 20 minutes before the meeting. Flaherty arrived just as we were going into the side room, next to Solomon's office, and Lucas was on my heels. This room was set up much like the interview rooms downstairs, but was reserved solely for staff use, and we'd all grabbed our favorite spots. By the time I joined Solomon's team, he'd already hired four others, all men. Matt Flaherty and Tony Delgado appeared to have a hardness about them, although I wouldn't like to run into either in a dark alleyway. Now I'd gotten to know them, I liked them. Lucas Givens is, like me, 10 years younger than they. He's a geek, disguised as a cutie pie with ruffled blonde hair that stands every which way and blue eyes that would make a Siberian husky jealous. There wasn't a computer system he couldn't hack, a phone he couldn't bug, or a paper trail he couldn't trace. Lucas also made great coffee, something I learned as he tutored me on the software that I would come to rely on. The jury was out on Steve Fletcher. He flicked a look at me and then away, his body turning towards Solomon. Great. He didn't like me. I wanted to know why. Lucas liked me. The other two tolerated me. Was it simply that I was a woman in a boy's game? Once again, that thought made me bristle. Solomon included, they each brought a case to the table. Solomon's wasn't up for scrutiny. On the cases he laid out, if he said jump, we jumped. He often disappeared, and I figured he was working on other stuff he didn't tell me about, but he didn't invite me to ask, so I didn't. He indicated Flaherty to go first. Flaherty's was a fraud case that looked interesting, but more a police matter than ours, so after a moment of thought, Solomon told him to kick it back to the client. Lucas brought a case of a man who thought his son was into drugs and wanted evidence. It was a simple case of surveillance. More interesting, the father was a prominent local lawyer and he wanted discretion. I saw a flash of interest in Solomon's eyes as he nodded approval. An inn with a law office would be useful, and Solomon was still reputation building. The third case, Delgado's, we also took. It was petty theft, but the owner of the restaurant owned 13 other establishments. Again, Solomon saw opportunity for more contacts beyond solving what appeared to be a straightforward case. Fletcher's was an unsolved murder of a young man whose girlfriend wanted someone to reopen. She was getting married soon, and he still weighed heavily on her mind. Plus, some new information had come to light in the form of a letter. Solomon gave Fletcher the nod and told him to team up with Flaherty.
Let's hear it, Solomon said, turning his gaze to me.
I opened my case file with Elizabeth's form, the financial details, and my note on the car. It's a missing person, I told them. She's 28, lived alone, job uncertain.
How missing? Solomon wanted to know.
2 weeks.
The police?
Informed. They weren't interested at first. Then, after Elizabeth did some pressing, they performed some cursory checks on her place. Didn't find anything, but the friend said someone had already been through the place.
The friend's the one who came in, not the parents? Boyfriend?
No parents, no boyfriend. Ex-foster kid. She pretty much doesn't have anyone except her friend. The police think she took off. I don't think so.
Why?
She wouldn't leave without telling the friend. From my peripheral vision, I saw Fletcher roll his eyes.
Ass. That isn't enough to go on, Solomon pointed out,
holding his hand out for the file. I pushed it towards him and he skimmed through it. It is for the friend. She knows her. She says this isn't her behavior. She wouldn't leave without telling her anything.
Plenty of people do, said Solomon. It happens every day. She has no ties to the area.
I think we should take the case.
Do you have anything stronger than a hunch? Sign of crime? A call for help?
I shook my head. No. She just vanished. Her car was impounded 11 days ago.
Most people who vanish don't want to be found.
She might want it. Maybe she's hurt.
There's no sign of that.
But
we can't take every case, Lexi, Solomon said with finality as he passed the folder back to me. Tell Elizabeth Fong to go back to the police. Put her in touch with Garrett if you want to throw her a bone.
Flaherty and Delgado quietly shuffled their case files and closed them. Lucas pretended to read his. Fletcher didn't do a thing, not even smirk. I wasn't sure if it was because no one wanted to get involved or no one wanted to tussle with the boss, the abandoned case, for instance, or because they all agreed that Marissa Widmore wasn't interesting enough to chase up. Even worse, that I couldn't handle my own case.
I want you working this case.
Solomon held up his file. We hadn't even discussed his, and no one had asked yet.
We need to take the cases we can work with, not the ones based on hunches. Dismissed.
The four men filed out of the room, and I watched as Flaherty tossed his case onto his desk to deal with later, but before it went into the archive box of turned-down cases that we kept just outside the door of the conference room. Please, I said, laying my hands on the table, fingers splayed. Solomon, this woman is certain something happened to her friend. Lily wouldn't leave me without saying something. Friends don't do that.
Friends do all kinds of weird shit.
I lowered my voice, not that anyone was hovering, but just in case. Solomon?
Lexi.
Solomon's voice took a warning tone, and he leaned forward, elbows on the desk, his fingers steepled together. His face took on the stern edge that I was getting used to when he shut down.
I've said no.
But
this is business.
Solomon's voice dropped an octave.
And if you want to earn respect from the other guys, you need to bring more to the table than a hunch.
That stopped me still. They don't respect me? Suspecting was one thing. Hearing it was quite another. Solomon didn't answer. Instead, he got up, walked around the table, and shut the door before returning to his seat. I could feel my nostrils flaring as the insult mushroomed in my mind. They only
see. We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.